Good afternoon. Welcome to Jonathan Edwards and the Church, a lecture series sponsored by the Jonathan Edwards Center and significantly by the Carl F. H. Henry Center for Theological Understanding. Very glad to have you with us today. We're looking forward to a wonderful lecture by Dr. Moody and a helpful pastoral response from Nathan Lemahue and good conversation with all of you in the audience as well. In fact, our agenda today is this. In just a moment, I'll introduce our two speakers formally, and when I do, they'll come and make their presentations without further introduction. But when they're done, I'll return to the lectern and moderate a time of discussion, questions and answers. I think you can tell that we're recording today's session. We have microphones set up in the aisles, so when it's time for Q&A, if you don't mind, line up behind the mics, and when it's your turn to speak, let us know who you are. If you're a pastor of a church in the area, tell us what church you serve and pose a question or a comment for our speakers. Thanks very much for being here. Our first speaker today is Pastor Josh Moody. Josh earned a PhD at the University of Cambridge and served as the college pastor of Eden Baptist Church in Cambridge, England, before moving to the U.S. to serve as senior pastor of two churches here, Trinity Baptist Church in New Haven, Connecticut, and the College Church of Wheaton, Illinois. He is the author or the editor of many books. I'm about to tell you about the ones that have most to do with Jonathan Edwards. They include Burning Hearts, Preaching to the Affections, which is hot off the press. That's a 2014 title. Jonathan Edwards and Justification, 2012. The God-Centered Life, Insights from Jonathan Edwards for Today, 2006, and Jonathan Edwards and the Enlightenment, 2005. He's an associate fellow of Jonathan Edwards College at Yale University, and he's done pioneer mission work in the former Soviet Union countries of Georgia and Azerbaijan. Our pastoral respondent is Nathan Lemahue, the campus pastor at Christ Church Highland Park, Illinois, a multi-site congregation that Nathan helped to launch in 2011. Prior to accepting the call to Christ Church, Nathan served as the pastor of music and young adults at the First Baptist Church of Oak Park, Illinois, and as an organ scholar at the University of Notre Dame's Basilica of the Sacred Heart. He holds the Master of Divinity degree from TEDS, Trinity Evangelical Divinity School, and the Master of Sacred Music degree from Notre Dame. He's also a graduate of Northwestern University with degrees in both music and political science. So we are delighted to have both Josh and Nathan here with us today. Would you join me in welcoming Dr. Moody to the podium?
Well, good afternoon. It's good to be with you, and I'm looking forward to this conversation. One of the things I would like to do is just get a sense of who's here. Before I try and help us understand a little bit more about Jonathan Edwards from my perspective. So, and I know, Doug, this is perhaps not going to be recorded, or maybe it's a little too off script, but it'll give me a sense of who I'm speaking to. How many, just so I can best serve you, how many of you have read a Jonathan Edwards sermon, just from start to finish? Okay. And how many of you have completed the Banner of Truth, tiny type, make you go blind set? Anyone completed that or read that? Okay, so we're kind of somewhere in between. And are you all working pastors or graduates? How many working pastors have we got here? Okay. And undergraduates? Any undergraduates? Graduate students? All right, that just gives me a sense of the range of what we're thinking about here as I try to introduce some thoughts for you. Nathan's getting really nervous because I sent him a very formal script, and now I'm talking completely off script, and so he's wondering how on earth you're going to respond to this, but the message will basically be the same. My name is Josh Moody. You just heard a very sort of erudite introduction to how wonderfully brilliant I am in all sorts of ways, none of which is true. Well, it is true, but I'm not wonderfully brilliant. I'm a normal human being, as you can all tell. And I am obviously British, which doesn't mean I drink tea at 4 o'clock every afternoon. You may think it does, but it doesn't. I have been in the States now since 1999, something like that. That's when we actually, I think, first came across. Doug and I met each other at Yale back in, maybe it's the mid-1990s, something like that. And so, and the reason why we came out here is we got called by church in New Haven. And so it's good to be with you. You seem very somber and serious. And I'm just wondering, I mean, I know we've got like a room of 200 and we got 20 people here or something, and that's fine. But I just want to engage with you. And as I try and give you something, I actually want it to serve you, okay? And be a part of something that I hope will be edifying and useful for you in your ministry. Let me set the stage of what I'm trying to do with you in this sort of way. It seems that Edwards lives within a couple of different caricatures. So Edwards is either presented as a sort of hellfire, brimstone, that sort of thing, caricature. And then on the other side, more recently, there's Jonathan Edwards is my homeboy. You know that caricature? Which is more positive and endearing, and you can buy T-shirts, and it's a little more contemporary. What is the truth about Jonathan Edwards? I first started studying Edwards a number of different years ago because I thought, and this is what I'm going to try and present to you this afternoon, that in Jonathan Edwards, there would be a resource for doing authentic and effective Christian ministry within the context of contemporary Western secularism. That's what I think is at the heart of what Edwards has to offer. And that's what I'm going to try and show in these five bullet points that I shared with Nathan a couple of weeks ago. I'm going to all try and prove this. There is in Jonathan Edwards a resource for doing authentic, and that's just a word to try and encapsulate biblical and holy, authentic and effective, using that word in terms of results. Results kind of language can sometimes seem a little crass, numbers, but effective in every possible way that we had hoped that Christian ministry would have a good result. So there is in Jonathan Edwards a resource for doing authentic and effective Christian ministry. So Edwards has a big architecture of intellectual apparatus that will be able to dive into a little bit, and maybe as we talk, we'll get into some more of that as well with question and answer. But Edwards was a pastor. So all this massive intellectual apparatus that he has, he's an acknowledged philosophical genius and Mozart of theology and all the rest. With all that, it's still for Christian ministry for Edwards, because Edwards was a pastor. Now, he did become president of what became Princeton and died before he did too much there, so he was also an intellectual. But Christian ministry was always, I think, at the forefront of what he's trying to achieve. So there is, in Jonathan Edwards, a resource for doing authentic and effective Christian ministry within the context of contemporary Western secularism. And I say that because the PhD thesis that Dr. Sweeney mentioned earlier was looking at how Jonathan Edwards' writings and life was responding to the Enlightenment. And the Enlightenment was the birth of Western secularism in many different ways, shorthand for a lot of things we could talk about there. And so what I think I discerned as I studied Edwards is that Edwards was proactively responding to the Enlightenment at a particular moment, particularly about what philosophers call epistemology, that is the theory of how you know, and particularly a spiritual epistemology, what I called knowing the presence of God. So right at the heart of the Western secularistic challenge to a Christian thinking, Christian living, is basically that it is not true, because you cannot know this God, because God is outside of the ability for us to actually engage with. Hence, Immanuel Kant, phenomenon, noumenon, you cannot really connect with this God who is there. And I think that I discern in Edwards, though, of course, Immanuel Kant came much later, nonetheless, you can trace in his writings, and in his preaching, and in his miscellanies, and in many of these different areas in which Edwards is engage a proactive response to this burgeoning enlightenment. That's what I think is at the heart of Jonathan Edwards. Let me try and explain to you why I think that and how that will help you, I trust, as a working pastor, someone who's training to be a pastor, and any Christian who wants to do any kind of ministry in their lives of whatever kind. And I've got four areas that I think drive this point. They're preaching, revival, mission, church, and then the last one is circling back to the introduction. I put here just in my notes, university or mind or apologetic, but it comes back to this mind of Edwards and how he engaged with the, and this is now me building upon Edwards' work, John chapter 1, the logos, the mind that is behind everything. So university, mind, apologetics. So preaching, revival, mission, church, university, mind. Okay? That's where we're going. All to drive forward this idea as Edwards is a resource for contemporary ministry of an authentic and effective kind responding to Western secularism. First then, preaching. Sometimes the question is asked whether Edwards was really an expository preacher. And in my view, it just depends how you define that question. I think Edwards was an expository preacher, because if you define exposition as the main point of the passage is the main point of the sermon, then when you read Edwards' expositions, which is what I think they were, you will find, in my view, that is what he is doing. Now, he has a very different structure to contemporary normal preaching. His structure is built upon the Puritan structure, and so there's a framework. In fact, one of the main differences of Edwards' preaching is just from our common experience of preaching today in the church is just how much time he spends on application. Use number one, use number two, use number 345, you know. And so there are all these different uses or applications or implications of a doctrine that he produces and then traces across scripture and then applies. But that doctrine, that message is, I still think, basically the same exposition. That is, it's the main point of the passage. And so I think he's doing expositional preaching, though of a slightly different kind to the one with which we are most familiar. I don't think that Edwards' preaching is most distinct in his rhetoric of judgment or hell, though he has that, but it isn't what makes him distinct from other preachers at the time. And other preachers historically, the language of calling people away from judgment and fear of hell is certainly something Edwards did, sometimes in pretty eye-opening ways, let me tell you. But though that is the case, it's not what makes him most distinct. What makes him most distinct, and I think his contribution and the way that he drives forward this response to Western secularism and being a useful tool for us in Western secularism, is the issue of what I call affectional, A-F, affectional expository preaching. Affectional expository preaching. Now, you have to, just to find exposition, you have to find affections. So I think for affections, what Edwards means is the heart. And by the heart, I think he means what the Bible means by the heart, which is the thinking, feeling, willing unit of the heart. So he doesn't just mean feelings when he says affections. He means the whole person. And Edwards deliberately targets this whole person in his preaching, affectional expository preaching. I promised that there'd be tools, so here are some for this regard, affectional preaching. I'm going to give you three. Number one, our own heart. So if we are, and as you read through Edwards, you'll discover there is this affectional thinking, feeling, willing, affectional intention. He says at one point, I want to raise the affections of my hearers as high as possible, as long as it's in accordance with the truth. So there's an affectional driving impetus behind what he's doing. If we are to aim to do that, I think we need to in our age, which is so driven by feelings. I think it's Rabbi Zacharias who says that we live in an age where people think with their feelings and they hear with their eyes. If that is true, and I think it is, how are we going to reach our people? Well, we need to do it by preaching biblically. And what we need to discern, I think Edwards helps us here, is that the biblical way of preaching expositionally is not only for impartation of truth, though it is that, but it's more than that. It is also for the deliberate intentionality of a shift of affection. How are we going to do that? Well, the first way we need to do it is with our own hearts. In other words, there is a kind of electricity to preaching. There's a kind of connectivity to preaching. And within our own personality, the way we have been shaped by an idea, by a truth, by a message, will communicate, whether we communicate waving our arms around a lot or walking around the stage a lot or not, doesn't matter. But if our own personality, our own heart has been, the truth has been molded in. So it's not just about saying, I need to apply what I'm teaching, though that's true. It's actually about letting, and this takes time, letting the truth permeate. I've got four children, and one of the things that my children like me to do is to cook omelets for them on Saturday morning. This is because I cannot cook anything else. And they like how I cook omelets. That's what children do. They're pleasant, you know. I don't know much about cooking omelets, but I do know this, that when you have three or four eggs, what you need to do is take the yolk and the white of the yolk and you need to beat them together. Bit like that. Somehow this truth needs to be pushed into the crevasses of our heart in order for that to carry across. So our own heart. Number two, tool in terms of preaching affectionately. The affections of the actual text. So the text in front of us actually has affections in it. So it's not like we're saying, well, this is kind of boring, but there's lots of information. Now I need to make you excited. We actually look at the text and we notice the pleading or the loving or the rejoicing. I'm preaching through Romans chapter 5 right now at College Church, and Romans chapter 5 is full of affectional language, so in that sense it's easy. What's a challenge with Romans chapter 5 in this way of preaching affectionally is how many different kinds of affections there are in it. Rejoicing, boasting, exultation, glorying, sufferings, hope. Somehow future-orientated that permeates into the present. Love, all in five verses. So you've got to notice these. That you've got to notice the truth, the logic, the argument. You've got to notice the affections. You've got to permeate your own heart. And then third tool under this first point of preaching affectionately, language. Language. Have you ever heard the story of the pastor who had in his notes as he was preaching a particular part of the sermon that he didn't feel very good about? And someone picked up his notes afterwards and they spotted on his notes that he'd scribbled next to this part of the sermon that he didn't feel good about the following: weak argument, shout louder. So preaching affectionately is not about being sentimental or enthusiastic without rationality. It's our own heart, it's the actual affections, the text, and it's the language that is employed. If we are biblical Christians, and I know we are here this afternoon, then we believe in the power of the word, and somehow in God's economy of words. And so crafting our sermons, crafting our preaching, when I say sermons, I don't just mean pulpit stuff, I mean heralding in conversation, in Bible study, at home, in devotional life, crafting our words so that the actual thought now has shape in language that then can have an impact. So those are three tools: our own heart, the actual text, language, preaching affectionately, all driving forward this main idea. Second, revival. So preaching, revival. Now, under this matter of revival, there have been many, many conversations about how you do revival, what is revival, what kind of revival should we have. It tends to unnerve people and excite people in different proportions, depending on how much they feel akin to the kinds of revival about which they have heard. There has been revival, and there has been revivalism. How can we unpick all this knotted string about revival? I think Edwards helps here. Obviously, Edwards is in many ways the theologian of revival for the church. And so when we think about revival, we do well to go back to Edwards. And one of the things among many which I notice is that Edwards, in accordance with his heritage, the Puritan heritage, and of his grandfather Solomon Stoddard and all that, primarily employed awakening language. I don't think that means it's wrong to employ revival language. It's number two in my bullet point, revival. But it's interesting to me that he does employ this language of awakening. And whether you use that language or another language that can help distinguish, it seems to me that we need to find a way of communicating a terminology within our culture as evangelicals that can affirm revival and God's sovereignty in revival, and our human responsibility to seek God, to ask for his Holy Spirit, as Jesus says we should. Our responsibility, God's sovereignty, in a way that doesn't go to the crazy. And so this language of awakening, I think at least, helps. Said I give you some tools, here are three. First, seems to me that in Edwards' thinking, one of the generators of revival is clarity about the nature of the gospel. Clarity about the nature of the gospel. In particular, it seems to me that Edwards recognized and articulated that especially justification by faith and clarity about that doctrine was a prime engine for the beginning of the first awakening and then the greater awakening later. So clarity. We often think revival is something that is a motive only, but in Edwards' thinking, doctrinal clarity about the true nature of the gospel and in particular justification by faith was important. Another whole massive conversation we don't have time for. Number one, in terms of generating revival under God's sovereignty. Number two, in Edwards' thinking, it seems to me that the other matter sometimes missed that seemed to him to be significant was not just justification, clarity about the nature of the gospel, in particular justification, but also testimony. He seemed to notice that God used particularly powerfully the testimony of certain people who had been converted to generate a desire after a similar encounter with God. What I think he meant by testimony was not just what we do at College Church, and you probably do in your own church, which sometimes you have someone come to the front and give a testimony, very good. Not just that, but the way in which if, say, whoever the drug pin lord, the guy who runs the drugs in Chicago, if that person suddenly got converted, we would know. People would know. It would have an impact. So somehow in God's sovereignty, testimony, a dramatic conversion, a narrative of surprising conversions, one of the books he wrote about this, has a profound impact. Justification, testimony, and then prayer. He wrote about this in his Concert of Prayer. And by prayer, Jonathan Edwards didn't just mean an individual praying, but a concert of prayer, which doesn't mean he had music around it, though he may have done. Dr. Sweeney may know more about it than I do. I just don't know. But that Edwards wanted a gathering, a corporate gathering of prayer, where God's people united their hearts for the purpose of seeing revival. And he thought when and if that took place, God would be more likely. In God's sovereignty, these particular ways were ways that God was more likely to send revival. Clarity around the gospel, testimony, and prayer. Now, I did a lot of work on this some years ago, particularly in the early 2000s, looking at different revivals down through history in relation to how some contemporary revivals were going. And one of the things that I noticed, and you can see this particularly in the Welsh revival, is that there is a tendency in revival for the first one to go. That is doctrine, preaching. There's a tendency to emphasize the experiential. So when there is revival, when we're looking for revival, we need those three, and we particularly need to guard that there'll be expositional preaching, doctrine, clarity around the gospel. Otherwise, what you have is increasing fuel, increasing fire, but it burns out the fuel. So we need constantly to be building into the movement of God, the truth about God, around justification in particular, but also Bible teaching in general. So preaching, revival, and then number three, mission. Preaching, revival, mission. And Edwards, as some of you will know, had a particular desire for promoting mission, and he did this through his diary of David Brainerd. And in this diary, he described David Brainerd in such a way as the principles that were important for Edwards theologically were also expressed on the frontier. So we have in our culture right now, way to do ministry within contemporary Western secularism, we have in our culture right now an increasing globalization. And so one of the questions that we're facing as a church in general is how much are we a mission church, a sending church, and how much are we a missional church? How much does it shape the way we do mission in the locality? Big conversation. What is Edwards' contribution? What I think Edwards' contribution is, and the diary of David Brainerd, massively influential, and people like David Livingstone, Hudson Taylor, others, enormously influential texts for the birth of the modern mission movement. What I think we discern is cost. So in the conversation as if we are to be effective in our culture today, missionally, as well as in mission, global mission, what needs to change? What parts of this heritage do we need to let go in order to pursue people? In that conversation, the contribution that Edwards brings is what needs to change is we need to change. There is a cost. There is a cost. So if we are to be people and church and a movement that take this gospel and press it in to postmodernism or post-postmodernism, wherever we are now. If we are to do that, we do need nuanced conversations about mission and missional. That's all good and proper. But I think Edwards' contributions, he describes the life of David Brainerd, is cost. It's going to cost. As I was thinking about this, I was reminded of Oswald Sanders, a great missionary leader, who said this. He said, "It is well these days of easygoing Christianity to remind ourselves that a Christ-sized work really will cost. course, you pick up the same thing in Scripture, don't you? Colossians 1, 24 to 28, this missionary cost that Paul describes there. I think that's the contribution. So, what parts do I need to give up? The parts I need to give up are the things that I don't want to give up because it's going to cost. I think that's his contribution, his call, really, under the category of mission. Preaching, revival, mission. Fourth, church. There's a lot of conversation in Edwards' scholarship about just how much was Edwards a theologian of the church. There's a wonderful new book that's come out recently by Rhys Bezant from Australia that describes this and answers some of those questions, showing how Edwards really was a theologian of the church. And you can see there's a number of different avenues. First and most obviously, I think, in the story of Edwards' life, he actually sacrificed, in a sense, his pulpit, his ministry at Northampton, where he was, around a principle that related to ecclesiology, namely the communion controversy. So whatever we think about Edwards' ecclesiology, he obviously cared a lot about it. The other place I think we can go to find out what Edwards thought, particularly about the ministry of the church, is one of his most famous sermons, where he preached at the induction of another pastor on John the Baptist, when he described John the Baptist is described as a burning and a shining light. And Edwards says, this is the model for what it means to be an excellent pastor. That is, we need to be both a burning with affection, shining with gospel clarity, light. And he preaches like that. It's a wonderful sermon. If you're thinking about going to ministry, let me commend it to you. If you are in ministry, haven't read it, let me commend it to you. In other words, what I think we can see in Edwards, if we categorize ecclesiologies under two very broad brush ways of describing them, like this: priestly, prophetic. I don't mean prophetic as angry or aggressive, but prophetic as in word-centered. Priestly or prophetic? Edwards lands in this camp over here, prophetic. And therefore, everything he does and thinks about the church, even when it comes down to the communion controversy and when he describes the ideal of a gospel minister as a burning and shining light, comes out of this overall category, which is a category I've given to him that's not actually in the text, but it's a way of trying to understand what he's saying. This prophetic category, preach the word, is right at the heart. And when I say that, I'm preaching to the choir because I'm at Trinity Evangelical Divinity School. But I think it is helpful for us to discern in one of the grandfathers of the modern evangelical movement, Jonathan Edwards, a deliberate intentionality around making sure that the word is at the heart of everything and drives forward everything. Not to leave aside the work of the Spirit, Edwards, theologian of revival, but nonetheless, the word is at the heart of everything, and that sets the tone, and other issues that may be difficult or maybe need to be jettisoned, maybe from our tradition, for him, the communion controversy, are then brought into line by that word. I know it's very difficult to do. I'm right now serving as a pastor of a very large church, and we have many, many, many resources. And right now, it is expected of me that I would give my time to the word and people, make sure that the phone doesn't bother me and sort of guard my time and all that kind of thing. But in a sense, this is a little easier for me right now, though there are many other distractions, I can tell you. But I do remember when I was in New Haven, when we were doing a church revitalization there. And it was a very small church at the beginning. Under God's grace, it grew, and it's now still thriving. But I remember the beginning when we were very small, making a deliberate decision because of this principle that I think I'd drunk from Edwards without really being able to categorize it like I just have now. Because of this principle, making a deliberate decision that even if other things fell off the table, I was going to make sure I did this. Some of you may remember that a few years ago, they used to have screensavers. You remember that computers, if they didn't have a little thing that moved around, you left it open for a while, the words on the screen would freeze into the screen, so they had a screensaver that moved around. You remember that? I had a screensaver that said on it, "Preach the word." It just used to reverberate round like this. "Preach the word, preach the word." Because of this principle. So let me encourage you, whether it's from the pulpit, whether it's from the lectern, whether it's in your family devotional life, to so prioritize the word that it actually does have an impact on your ecclesiology and your understanding of church as well. So, preaching, revival, mission, church. Finally, we're coming back full circle. Remember I said that there is, I think, in Jonathan Edwards, a resource for doing authentic and effective Christian ministry within the context of contemporary Western secularism. So this is at least partly not just practical, giving you, I hope, many different tools, but also framework, intellectual, even apologetic. And so we come to this final point, university, mind, apologetic. What I think I discern in Edwards as a useful tool, a contribution for us as working pastors, teachers, people engaged with issues of truth today, is a wonderful poise, balance between creativity and orthodoxy. So one of the things that frightens people when they begin to read Edwards is just how creative he was. He came up with some really quite creative ideas. And you read that and you think, for instance, at one point he says, and I'm paraphrasing now, at one point he says the Trinity is a doctrine that is able to be entirely rationally proven. And you think, well, really? And yet Edwards has a whole superstructure around that, and he means that in the sense of way in which when we're enlightened by God's Spirit, we will discern that actually this is entirely rational. And then it is entirely rational, rationally proven. But he has this and some other ideas. Even slightly more strangely, he has a whole series of reflections about matter, the stuff of life, and how this substance is not really the substance, using Aristotelian language, that actually behind everything is the one true substance, God. God who is, as it were, constantly perceiving, hence his idea of continuous creation. God is, as it were, what we're seeing around us is as miraculous as if we had been present on the days of creation itself, this continuous creation. These are creative ideas. And yet he's also determinedly, almost rigidly, orthodox. And in the life of the mind, we struggle with that because we want to be creative and yet we want to be orthodox, and they feel like they're poles apart and they're dragging us in two different directions. And yet here's Jonathan Edwards, acknowledged genius, Einstein of theology, and there is a, I don't want to say creative orthodoxy because that would sound almost as bad as creative accountancy. But there is an orthodox creativity. Why? How? Part of it is just because he was very bright. But not all very bright people remain orthodox. I think it's because Edwards genuinely believed and genuinely practiced the principle that Scripture is not a prison to your mind. It does not restrict your mind. Scripture is not a prison to your mind, but actually is a seed, like a pebble thrown in a lake, ripples go out to the far shore. And so while you see all these creative reflections, you also hear at the same time that Edwards was, of all pastors, the one who his contemporaries observed most studied the Bible. Preaching, our own heart, the actual text, smashing it into our own heart, the actual text, the affections in the text, language that expresses and encapsulates, frames the affections, preaching, revival, justification, the actual doctrine, clarity around the gospel, testimony, power of testimony, prayer, concert of prayer, mission. This pioneer idea of mission and missional that it's going to cost church, prophetic, that is, preaching the word at the heart, and how that was something that even cost Edwards. This idea of the mind, the poise, the balance, and orthodox creativity born, I think, generated, I think, from a conviction the Bible is not a prison to your mind, but is seed, a seed which will grow your understanding more and more and more. So all that to say, my friends, as we just think about these things together, I'll look forward to what Nathan has to do in just a moment as he responds and then we interact. All that to say, there is in Jonathan Edwards, I think, a resource for doing authentic and effective Christian ministry within the context of contemporary Western secularism. And let me commend him to you for that end.
Well, like Josh, I also was familiar with Edwards before he became the poster boy for the Young Reformed movement, although in my case, it hasn't prevented me from owning the t-shirt that says, Jonathan Edwards is my homeboy, which I think my wife got as a Christmas gift for me several years ago, bless her heart. I imagine if you got together all of the wives who felt compelled to buy Jonathan Edwards apparel for their husbands, it would make up quite a therapeutic support group for these poor women. Well, I hope to comment on at least three of the areas that Josh has highlighted this afternoon, beginning with preaching, with Edwards' idea of affectional expository preaching. And as Josh has mentioned, it's clear what most of us mean by the expository part, even though the structure of our messages differs from that of Edwards and his 18th century contemporaries, but the main point of the passage is the main point of the message, and that's expository. But when it comes to affectional preaching, I sometimes struggle to know how to use Edwards. I haven't read Josh's new book yet, and I'm sure that will help. But it's because for me, on the one hand, I picture the Edwards who wrote Religious Affections, and I know that his preaching was aimed intentionally at the heart. As Josh quoted, Edwards says, I want to raise the affections of my hearers as high as I possibly can. But at the same time, we envision Edwards with his wig, shut up in his study for 13 hours a day, coming out to preach what would seem to us like rather lengthy messages in a kind of dry style and delivery. And we sense this kind of disconnect. This is not what I picture when I think of moving somebody to action. Surely the raising of the affections for our listeners must look different in some way, because what I'm picturing over here is never going to work. And I think it's easy to bemoan that fact. I'll at least speak for myself. And I sometimes think, if only I could move the affections like Edwards did, with pure logic, with logic on fire, as Martin Lloyd-Jones puts it, then I wouldn't have to worry about emotionally manipulating people with tears and yelling and all of those things. And it would be a much purer experience. This is the kind of thing I try to convince myself of. If Edwards was able to raise the affections of his listeners in this way, then I should be able to do it too. And if it doesn't work, it's a reflection on your inability to be moved, not on my inability to move you. Many of us may have thought along these lines from time to time, so let me suggest a couple of things. First, when it comes to affectional preaching, let Edwards be a guide for how to study God's word deeply, how to find the pathos of the text, how to long for and pray for changed listeners. But don't let Edwards be an excuse for some kind of homiletical, methodological snobbery, or worse yet, an excuse for laziness in failing to do the hard work of understanding what really will speak to our listeners today. Second, use Edwards in conjunction with today's preachers who share in his vision for affectional expository preaching. Whose words have awakened your heart? Who has made the pathos of the text so real for you that you felt you had no choice but to go out and do something about it? And it's much more than just about mimicking somebody's style. It might mean, as Josh mentioned, reworking our vocabulary. The Gospel Coalition put out a video last week with Piper and Carson and Keller in which Tim Keller talks about the dictionary of affect, a tool for judging whether the words we use create any sort of mental images. And he confesses that not only does his writing fall short of C.S. Lewis when processed through this tool, but that Lewis uses 5 times the number of evocative words as he does. Last spring, Cornelius Plantinga was here at the Henry Center, and I came to know a bit about his book called Reading for Preaching, how interacting with poets and with storytellers and biographers can help us in this quest, evoking images that will cut to the heart, that will raise the affections, that will penetrate into the thinking, feeling, willing core of a person and move them to action. If our goal is affectional expository preaching, let's be eager to work just as hard at the affectional piece as we do on the expository side. Second, revival. According to Edwards, revival is the most effective way that God grows his kingdom. It's the main engine for church growth. At various places in his writings, Josh has encouraged us to imagine what Jonathan Edwards might think if he walked into one of our churches today. And this area of revival, I think, would be one where there'd be considerable misunderstanding. If you were to ask me, how is your church growing? It would be obvious to me what you were really asking. You'd be asking one of two questions, and possibly both. First, what programs are you using to attract new people to your church? And second, what is your marketing plan for making people aware of your church? But if you were to ask Edwards the same question, how is your church growing? I suspect he would not identify these same two questions floating beneath the surface. Because to ask Edwards, is your church growing, would really be to ask, have you experienced revival or awakening? And that in turn would beg the question, have you put into place the tools and the conditions that make revival most likely to occur? Namely, is your preaching gospel-centered? Are stories of conversion being told and celebrated? And are people uniting together in corporate prayer for revival? I sometimes get the feeling that if someone asked me, how is your church growing, and I gave Edwards' answer, I might be seen as dodging the question. You know, yeah, the preaching and the prayer, we got all that. But really, how is your church growing? I feel like you're hiding something. Well, the fact that I would feel slightly embarrassed or inadequate to answer the question in Edward's way, I don't think is a good sign. Finally, a prophetic church versus a priestly church. It's clear to me as a leader that a prophetic understanding of the church is more appealing. I would prefer an active role rather than a passive one. I'd rather be bringing the food as a waiter out to the tables rather than simply standing behind the buffet line waiting for people to come and pick and choose whatever seems good to them at the moment. But I want to think about everybody else. What attitude or posture should we be fostering among the community that's gathering to worship? Last year, I was standing at the front door of our church greeting people prior to a morning worship service, shaking hands, saying good morning and such. And one little girl came up to me and looked me right in the eye and said, "Good morning, Jesus." And I looked up at her parents for a cue on what I should say to her. You never want to correct a foundational belief of a four-year-old without understanding that a bunch of other beliefs are probably going to come crashing down at the same time. And I came to understand that at home, the girl had been asking, "Why do we go to church on Sundays?" And mom and dad had been telling her, "We go there to meet Jesus, to find Jesus." And so she puts two and two together. I'm the face she associates with church. We go to church to meet Jesus, and here I am. Now, ignoring her blasphemy for a minute, there's still something right about her thinking. And that is, even within a prophetic view of the church, the worshiper's role is not completely passive. We're told, "Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near." And the key, of course, is seeking the right thing. We come to meet Jesus through his word, through his body as seen in the sacraments and in the fellowship we share. And so I'd like to think that my job within the context of a prophetic church is not to foster a completely passive community, and I doubt that's what Edwards has in mind, but our responsibility is to train hearts to seek after the right things so that I come to worship not asking, "Oh Jesus, how much of an allowance should I give to my teenager or whatever?" But rather, "Oh Jesus, how much of yourself have you given for me?" That's what I'm coming to hear. That's what I'm actively seeking. And in a prophetic church, that's what will be faithfully proclaimed.